Earlier, I talked with Dr. Sarah Kaiser about how she got into quantum, how she got into tech, and some of the stuff that she does. And now she's actually going to walk us through a demo using Q#, and you don't want to miss this. Check it out. Hey, Sarah. All right, so talk us through the demo and tell us what we're looking at.
Yeah, so I'm gonna show a couple kind of like the hello world examples for Q#, what it kind of looks like to use qubits. So qubits are the direct analog to bits in your classical computer. They're kind of the fundamental unit of information in a quantum computer. And so we'll look at how we actually use those, and then I'll show an example of an algorithm called the Bernstein-Vazirani algorithm that actually shows a pretty clear like example of the speed ups that you can get with quantum hardware.
Awesome.
All right, so we've got a demo here. I've got basically some code cells, kind of like a Jupyter notebook. And you can see, a good hello world example is basically you just make a string that prints something out. So I've defined a function here called greeting. You can see it takes the arguments name, which is a string type. So Q# is a strongly typed language. So I like types. I like seeing, hopefully.
Yeah, what, same.
what should go where? So now that the kernel spun up, this lets me know that that's been kind of added to our environment. There are tons of different ways to run Q#. I'm currently running from a Jupyter notebook. So I'm basically going to ask the Jupyter notebook to simulate this function and pass it the parameter that I want. So, hello world, Christina.
Nice, I love it. And I love that there's also a heart there, that's awesome.
Yeah, I'm sorry, tech does not have enough sparkles and hearts in it, so you'll find this all over in my commit messages. okay, so that's kind of like a good first bit. If we go and kind of talk a little bit about using qubits and what that looks like. Qubits, you can, in Q#, think of them as a resource that you request from the runtime when you need them, and you return them when you're done. So I'm going to start here by opening one of the libraries. Q# comes with a ton of really great libraries with a lot of stuff just already defined, and you don't have to re-implement them. Here I have an operation. So operations here meaning I'm actually going to kind of interact with something that's not deterministic. Qubits are not necessarily deterministic. And what I'm going to make is actually basically a quantum coin. So this is a quantum random number generator. That's what QRNG stands for. And here I'm using the using statement to ask our runtime for a qubit. I'm going to do an operation on it. So that's this H here. This is the Hadamard operation and basically puts our qubit in superposition. So you've possibly heard that word before, in relationship to quantum stuff, but it basically means I'm putting it in a linear combination of both 0 and 1. And then I'm just going to measure and reset that qubit. And so what I would expect if I simulate this is basically a 50-50 head, like coin toss. So I can simulate that a bunch of times. This is kind of like a really basic, I guess, hello world, but for qubits. You basically make this coin flip machine. Okay, so now that we've seen at least kind of the basic hello world, our qubit hello world, let's actually kind of look at what an application might look like for this. So first I have to set up a little bit about a problem. So I'm going to give you, Christina, a function which takes a dot product between an input string and a secret string that's hidden in this function. So basically, you have a bit string that goes in, it has a secret bit string, and you dot product them together. I will also give you a quantum oracle. Now, that sounds, quantum physicists are really whimsy about their naming. There's tons of like Merlin and Arthur and oracles and stuff all over in the theory papers. There's even magic states, which are just, it's awesome. But that's a quantum oracle is basically a way that we can take a classical function like the f of x function that we have here and run it on a quantum computer. So it's kind of like the necessary wrapper, if you will, to make it easy to run that classical function on our quantum computer. So I'll give you basically, I'll give you both of those things, and we're going to try to figure out what the secret string that's hidden in this function is. Now, I get that this maybe not does not seem a terribly practical problem, but I think it's a good toy problem to kind of demonstrate what we can do with quantum hardware. So if we were trying to solve this classically, we would basically have to put in, so into that function, we basically have to probe each bit of the secret, because we can get, if it's a dot product, we just put a one in the position of the bit that, of the secret that we want to learn, and we just scan it all the way through. So that would take us, if our secret is n bits long, n kind of queries or uses of that function. For the quantum strategy that we're going to use here, it's only going to take us one query. So like a n scaling to a one scaling is a pretty good speed up, if you ask me.
I think so. That's very impressive.
Certainly in real applications, you'll have some other overhead and everything balances out. So this isn't exactly the speed up you would get, but this is kind of a good example of a subroutine that you could use in your quantum algorithms. So I'm going to again open some libraries here that are going to help us. And I'm going to kind of add the definition for our oracle that I mentioned earlier. So you can see here, the details here aren't super important, but basically we have an operation here that's going to do the dot product, because that's basically what our function f does, right? It does a dot product. So we can define those. And then we can actually run our Bernstein-Vazirani algorithm, where we're going to leverage superposition to basically query all of the possible bits of our secret at once. So again, we're using qubits, so we've got an operation here. Our inputs are how many qubits are there, and, do we want to use, basically, and how what is the secret? So here I'm passing a integer as our secret, and we'll convert it to a bit string. And it should return, our result here should be basically the same as the secret that we put in. So that's our expected result. Here again, we're using the using statement to get some qubits. We're using some really neat patterns like the within apply blocks from Q-sharp that make it really easy. Quantum algorithms often have this pattern of like prepare your qubits, do some things, and then unprepare them. And so Q-sharp has this built-in kind of block style within apply, which means basically Q-sharp does a lot of the kind of undoing and cleaning up after myself for me. Mm-hmm. So that's a really great example of this like domain-specific design of the language. You can kind of maybe think of it as kind of analogous to like automated memory management as opposed to having to do that manually.
Nice.
So yeah, so we can evaluate that, and so we've got that in our memory. And let's just simulate it. So ideally, this should return to us the number 19. So if we work this out in binary, this is 16, 17, 18, 19. OK, cool. my binary skills are OK. So here you can see we were, again, using this simulate call in the Jupyter notebook. And what that's doing is that's running on the simulator or simulated quantum device on my laptop here. You can simulate up to about 30 qubits on a reasonable laptop sort of hardware. But that's that isn't as exciting as running on hardware. So let's actually run it on hardware. There is basically this new service called Azure Quantum, where the devices that Microsoft is developing and other partners are developing will be available as basically instances on Azure. So I can connect to a workspace on Azure right now from the IonQ partner. And let's see. Yep, so everything, I've connected to the workspace. And I'm going to set my target device as the IonQ QPU, or quantum processing unit.
Nice.
But yeah, this is really exciting. And so there's a number of different hardware partners that are on Azure Quantum already. It's in preview right now. So you can sign up on the Azure Quantum or Microsoft Quantum website to get into that preview.
That's awesome.
All right,
there we go.
Here, we'll zoom out. All right, there we go. All right, so now I've submitted, you can see here I've submitted this job and it's running. There are some queue times here, so we'll pop over and let me just take a look at my jobs so I can just straight here from my notebook. Yeah, so you can see here all of the different jobs I've sent out to different devices and device simulators. So this is the one that we're waiting on right now. I'm gonna grab the results from the one I ran a little bit earlier.
Perfect.
And I actually also ran it on Honeywell hardware. So these are two different hardware partners, and you know, maybe it's not super exciting or surprising, but we basically get back from the hardware a histogram of what secret, it's not, basically the algorithm isn't going to get exactly the same answer every time because of noise in the device. But we can see here with like 95% probability, we got, again, 19 in binary, and on our IonQ device, same thing.
Yeah.
So yeah, like, I don't know, like, it's really, it may seem kind of silly to be like, we put in 19 and we got 19 back out, but this was actually running on quantum devices at almost absolute zero, somewhere on the other side of the country. So, you know, the possibilities
That's awesome.
That we have to actually develop with this are really, really cool.
Yeah, no, I love that. That's incredible. And the fact that you can do all of that like from a Jupyter notebook makes it, I think, feel more accessible too, because as you're pointing out, like, okay, it's great that you have this, you know, like if you could do it on your local hardware, you know, that maybe could do 30 qubits, right? Mm-hmm. But if you're wanting to do bigger problems that could take up more than that, being able to do that remotely and do that in the cloud and have more experimentation, that's really awesome. I love that. Where can people go to learn more from you about Q-Sharp?
So definitely come check out and hang out on stream with me at twitch.tv/crazy4pi314. It's my original internet username and I'm sticking to it. You can
Love
come
it.
Ask whatever questions you want about quantum computing, see what it looks like to actually write software for a quantum computer. I'd also encourage you to check out qsharp.community. So that's a community group that myself and some other MVPs help maintain to kind of show off other projects that folks are doing with QSharp and just kind of interact with folks who are actually using it. And I'd also encourage you to check out WICA, Women in Quantum Computing and Applications. It's a really fun meetup group where basically we feature talks and profiles of women who are actually working in quantum computing. I've written a book called Learn Quantum Computing with Python and Q-Sharp. It assumes no quantum background and allows you to kind of, with your classical developer skills, build up what you need to know about quantum computing by literally building a simulator yourself in Python and then kind of seeing how that is manifest in Q-Sharp and the quantum development kit, and then using that to actually build things like do chemical simulations in Q-Sharp.
That's awesome. That's awesome. So you're telling me that I don't need to have a quantum background, but if I'm a developer, I can read your book and kind of go through that whole process.
Mm-hmm.
That's yeah. awesome. And in addition to the textbooks, you've written some other books too, from what I understand, right? So they're maybe
yeah.
geared towards a little bit different audience.
Yeah, we cater to all ages here. You know, I really enjoy kind of showing what's exciting about tech to everyone. So I brought a couple copies here. We've got robotics for babies, neural
nice.
Networks for babies, which is always a hit, and ABCs of engineering. So, you know, I only have a fur baby, but I always bring them when folks have kids, and it's really fun to see, you know, a kid get really excited about learning about those things. So
that's awesome. And what got you interested in writing books, you know, geared at babies?
Yeah, that's a good question. So one of my academic colleagues, Chris Ferry, who's the co-author with me on those books, so he has four kids. He had actually written some of these baby books like for quantum computing, which kind of started out as a Reddit troll and then spun out of control, and now he's like an award-winning children's book author. So
wait, back up. So this started as like a troll and then it became like a real thing?
Yes. Basically what happened was someone on Reddit said, you can't explain quantum computing to a baby. He said, watch me. He posted basically an Imgur thread of the pages of the book, people were like, you need to self-publish this. He self-published on Amazon. And then at one point, Mark Zuckerberg posted a picture of him reading this book to his kid. And then he had publishers out the wazoo.
That's so good. That's so good. I love it so much. I love it. Well, Sarah, thank you so much. It was so great talking with you. I love learning about your background. I love that you've made me, like, I feel like even I can understand some of this stuff now. It's a lot more approachable. Keep up the great work, and I'll see you in Animal Crossing.
Thanks so much, Christina. It's been really great to talk.
Love it.
That does it for this series on Code Stories. I want to thank Dr. Sarah Kaiser for taking the time to share her story with us. It's amazing, and for showing us so much cool code. If you want to know more about her, you can find her at her website, stkaiser.com. You can also check out more resources on getting started with Q# at microsoft.com/learn. We've got some really good resources there. I've also got links in the show notes in the description to Sarah's Twitch stream and some of the blog posts and books that she's written. And while you are there, just go ahead and subscribe to us on YouTube at Microsoft Developer, and we're going to see you next time.